This is the second Sunday of Pentecost, and we are reading from the Gospel of John, chapter 3, verses 1 through 17. Hear these words. Now there was a Pharisee named Nicodemus, a leader of the Jews. He came to Jesus by night and said to him, "Rabbi, we know that you are a teacher who has come from God. For no one can do these signs that you do apart from the presence of God." And Jesus answered him, "Very truly I tell you, no one can see the kingdom of God without being born from above." Nicodemus said to him, "How can anyone be born after having grown old? Can one enter a second time into the mother's womb and be born?" Jesus answered, "Very truly I tell you, no one can enter the kingdom of God without being born of water and spirit. What is born of the flesh is flesh, and what is born of the spirit is spirit. Do not be astonished that I said to you, you must be born from above. The wind blows where it chooses, and you hear the sound of it, but you do not know where it comes from or where it goes. So it is with everyone born of the Spirit." Nicodemus said to him, "How can these things be?" Jesus answered him, "Are you a teacher of Israel, and yet you do not understand these things? Very truly, I tell you, we speak of what we know and testify of what we have seen, yet you do not receive our testimony. If I have told you about earthly things and you do not believe, how can you believe if I tell you about heavenly things? No one has ascended into heaven except the one who descended from heaven, the Son of Man. And just as Moses lifted up the serpent in the wilderness, so must the Son of Man be lifted up, that whoever believes in him may have eternal life. For God so loved the world that he gave his only Son, so that everyone who believes in him may not perish, but have eternal life. Indeed, God did not send the Son into the world to condemn the world, but in order that the world would be saved through him." May the Lord add a blessing to the reading of God's word. Today we are again in the Gospel of John, and I'd like to use on this second Sunday of Pentecost the gray matters of the Holy Spirit, the gray matters of the Holy Spirit. As you all know, out of all the social media forums that there are out there, I tend to kind of groove with Facebook. And so about a couple of months ago, I posted on my personal Facebook page a scenario I had seen on somebody else's page, and I want to share that scenario with you today. Listen, you loaned $3,000 to your friend last year, and since then he or she has refused to pay you back, which has really deteriorated your friendship. You begged him or her just to pay you back $1,000 and forget the rest because you are in a financial crisis. Your friend then says he or she can only get you $500 since that's all he or she has. You felt like you had no option but to accept, so you eventually give him or her your account details and to send the amount directly to your bank. You wake up the next morning, check your account, and lo and behold, there's $5,000 in your account. You keep staring at the screen in disbelief, but it is indeed $5,000 in your bank. You grab your phone and you find out that you've missed 50 calls from your friend and an additional 20 text messages begging you to transfer back $4,500. He only meant to send you $500, but he added that extra zero. What are you going to do? So I gave the people on my list a choice between 1, 2, and 3, and 1 being send back the whole $4,500. 2, take your full $3,000 out. I see a head nodding in the congregation. We only got about 4 heads, but 1 was nodding. And 3, keep the entire amount. So for some reason, this really triggered people, and a lot of people responded. I got 40 responses, people. This post was triggering. A few people said that they'd keep the entire amount. The majority of people said they would take their $3,000. And very few people said they'd send $4,500 back. Out of 40 responses, five people said something a little different. And I want to share three of those responses here with you today. Response number one, I would take the absolute minimum of what I need with a maximum of $3,000 and send the rest back. The friend is at fault for not being honest and refusing to pay, but although they weren't being fair, I wouldn't want them to hurt because of me being greedy. That's just how I am. I wouldn't fault anyone if they wanted to take $3,000. That's just not my choice. Response number two, I would take my full $3,000. Principal fact, this person lied. If this person said he didn't have it, but he really did, but he really didn't, I would send him back the money. But the fact is, this person lied. And the last response was one that was the most interesting to me. Response number three, depends on my situation, really. If I was in a privileged position where I could afford to kiss $3,000 goodbye, then maybe I would just give the $4,500 back and consider it charity and maybe learn from the experience. If not, then I would probably return the $2,000 and keep my $3,000. Either way, I would have a hard conversation with the friend to understand why they told me they didn't have the money and why their financial stability is more important than my own. And we probably wouldn't be friends anymore, but who knows? Maybe the friend needs that $2,000 to pay her rent or feed her kid. Life is complicated. What I ultimately learned from this scenario is that life is complicated and that there's a lot of gray, and we have the Holy Spirit to help navigate gray matters. But I'm curious, those of you that are in YouTube land, those of you that are in Facebook land and Zoom, what would you do? I'd love for you to post. We talk about in this whole internet era that it's good to try to engage people that are listening, that we don't just want you to sit there and listen, but we want to be engaging. And so today, I'd really love for you guys to post, what would you do? I'd love in coffee hour, maybe for you guys to discuss what would you do. And in YouTube, you can leave a comment, what would you do? This is where we enter the biblical text. Nicodemus comes to Jesus by night. He comes to Jesus in privacy. He begins talking to Jesus about his popularity and his signs and his power. He even makes a few proclamations in terms of, we know where you come from based on what you have done. And Jesus answers him by telling him he must be born again. Wait a minute, this is like a suspense movie in which you don't see the next scene coming and you're taken by surprise because Nicodemus never really asked a question. And one can get the feeling that there are parts of this conversation that we are obviously missing because Jesus' response is totally, totally different. I once had a friend that gave me some advice about public speaking when I was feeling a little bit nervous about an opportunity coming up. And she said, people will invite you to speak on this thing or that thing. And she said, but I've learned what is my area of expertise. She said, and I stick to it. I don't let people get me off of what is my area of expertise. She said, it doesn't really matter to me what they call me to speak on. I speak on what is my area of expertise, and it always seems to work out. She said to me, never let someone get you away from your message, the message that God has given you. And I wonder, as I'm reading this text today, if Jesus is like my friend. He's like, I'm sticking to my message and why God sent me on the road trip to earth in the first place. He listens, but in the end, he sticks to his message. He might use wine, he might heal, he might teach, but the objective is always the same, to reach people and set them on a better path. Nicodemus, you need to get born again. Nicodemus is thrown off a little bit too. He's like, I've been through my mom's womb once. How do you suggest I pull it off twice? He says, how is a grown man able to be born again? Is he able to go into the womb of his mother a second and be born? You see, Nicodemus is operating in the black and white. I find some Christians like that, you know, conservative Christians that want to bop everybody over the head because they want to look at everything in black and white. And often, it's not black and white. Often, there's a lot of gray. So he's going on this literal route like some Christians do today. And Nicodemus is missing the boat. Jesus responds, you must be born from above. Totally gray matter. You must be born of water and spirit. Totally gray matter. Jesus answered and said to him, amen, I say to you, unless someone is born anew, that person is not able to see the reign of God. You must be born from above. The Spirit is not something we do, but something we prepare for and stay ready to receive. You see, we are comfortable with doing this thing. We're comfortable with knocking this off our list, but it's harder for us to just sit still and wait. We invite the Holy Spirit, and then we wait for the Holy Spirit. That's what the disciples did. Often in our joys and concerns, when we used to meet together, after someone had stated a joy or a concern, then we would say, come, Holy Spirit. You see, we actually need the Holy Spirit to live in our lives. It's not just a Pentecost moment. It's not just a one Sunday moment, but we need it every week and every day. The disciples gathered on last week, and what did they do? They waited for the Holy Spirit so that they could then be emboldened and feel like they could do what God was asking them to do and get busy. But first, they had to wait, and they were not disappointed in Pentecost. Pentecost did not disappoint them. Imagine how different our lives would be if we consulted with the Holy Spirit every now and then when it came to tough life decisions facing us. In the past year, we've been living with COVID. We learned we did not have to be in a building to worship. But prior to COVID, many people thought we did. And we did not have to gather physically to be the church. But many people thought that we had to. We met with new people from across the world, and we met other people. And we are meeting new people. And we did communion in our homes, and we looked in our refrigerators and found what was there. And we came to the table. And we met, and we did meetings when we swore we could not do quality meetings on Zoom, but we did them anyway. And we stretched in terms of how we view ourselves as a community of faith. We were forced to sit with ourselves a little bit longer and slow down. We were forced to sit with people maybe we didn't like that lived in our homes. We were forced to do some things differently. And maybe some of us learned something about ourselves. And now we will begin an outdoor worship service on the last Sunday in June. And get this, in July, we are opening the church back up. And we will do indoor worship once again. But I am concerned. You know, I have a fear. I wonder if we will just go back to business as usual, if we'll just get back to doing things the way that we always have done them, instead of maybe saying we learned some things from COVID that will cause us to do ministry differently. The Holy Spirit helps us to be church in a different way, and now we have a taste. So let's not be comfortable again with doing things the same old way, because it's been passed down from generation to generation. The same objective, different path, same destination will get you there. I notice when I cut on my GPS, it gives me about three different ways to go. But check this out. Even though it's three different paths, all of those three different ways and routes they give me lead to the same destination. Yes, you can. You can do church outside of the church. You can do church in a park. You can do church in your home. Different way, same destination. God is doing something different here at United, but God is doing something different in the world, and we need the Holy Spirit to guide us. What would it look like if sometimes we ask the Holy Spirit about our future? You see, the Holy Spirit helps us in gray matters, leading us to operate and try new things, same objective in mind, sharing the good news and being the good news, but in a different kind of way. want to tell you about a sister church today that kind of really blew my mind. Doing the same thing we do, being the same church, but doing it in a different kind of way. On the north side, our sister church called Gilead. Gilead has been around for maybe about 7 years. Maybe you would consider it a new church start. And so Gilead decided that they didn't want to meet in church buildings. They met in restaurants. They met in some different, unique kind of spaces. But they decided for their church, they did not want to meet in a typical church building. For communion, the pastor decided to serve beer and bread instead of wine, grape juice, and bread. The co-pastors thought there is so much seriousness around church, and to appeal to a younger crowd, we need to mix things up. But they didn't just go to the store. They made their very own beer. They made it, they hand-labeled it, and they bottled it. And Rebecca Anderson, the co-pastor, says, Christianity is so serious, and there are ways where the stakes are high. When you're in a hopeless place, and you have a faith that gives you energy, but there's also a way where Christianity is supposed to be a joyful way of life. And there are so many ways of doing it that aren't joyful. I hope the beer indicates a sort of lightness. Now, don't get stuck up on the beer, because remember, it's all about doing it a different way, but the same objective. We're still calling people into community. We're still calling people to the table. The truth is, more and more, the world lives in the gray matters, and we will either get there or we will either be worshiping by ourselves. The church has lived a long time in black and white matters, but with the Holy Spirit, we are being called on the outside of our church. In fact, just last week, the director of the Hyde Park Chamber of Commerce asked to meet with me outside on our lawn. As you know, I'm not going to go over this again. A lot of folks are outside. In fact, there are more folks outside than there are folks inside. Same mission, same goal, just doing it differently. So I began today talking about this situation where a friend borrowed money. It's a hypothetical situation, but a lot of people could relate. And I began to realize that a lot of people have been burnt in life. I got a lot of opinions. I doubt many of them asked the Spirit first. I doubt many of them prayed about it. My response was, I'm more amazed at you all responses than the person that supposedly borrowed the money. The responses were amusing. It's tempting to keep the money. It's fair to take what's owed to you and give the rest back, and it's noble to send it all back. Many of us have been down that road. I have a friend that practices in giving a loan that they don't give anything that they can't afford to lose. And so when her and her husband loaned money, they decided they wouldn't loan anything that they couldn't afford to get back. And so when they give someone, they give it with the intent that it's yours for good. And here's my answer, because my friends say I don't answer questions, I just pose them. I take the 3,000 too, and depending on what day of the week, I might do a little more than that. But here's the thing, it's just one more opinion. And in Gray Matters, we don't need just one more opinion, we need the Holy Spirit. What might the Spirit be saying to us? How might we move on a chessboard differently if the Holy Spirit was guiding us? Following the Holy Spirit makes our journey, makes our life a lot more interesting. A friend's church did this, and I was impressed. One of the finance people stole the money. And before we look at this church in disdain, every church I have served in, there's been someone that has stole the money. I don't know. It's a tempting kind of thing. But this church, same as any other church, somebody took some of the money that didn't belong to them. I could ask you, what would you do? I could think about what I would do. But I could ask you, and I'm sure, again, we'd have a whole lot of opinions. But this group consulted the Holy Spirit, and they decided that the person that took the money, that soul was more important than the money they took. And so they reached out to him because they didn't want to lose him. And so they talked to him and they said, you know, we know that you made a decision that was bad. And so they set up a payment plan with him and said, this is how much you are to pay us monthly. We will keep this confidential and we want you to continue to come to church. And that man paid off his loan. And that story blessed me. It blessed me because it wasn't another opinion, but I could feel the Holy Spirit. We are beautifully and wonderfully made by God. And some days I just have to pause because the power of that is overwhelming. But we can do so much more and we can be so much more if we just invite the Holy Spirit to weigh in. I promise you, the Spirit has a much, much better plan than we could ever imagine. Let the Holy Spirit raise you up. Let the Holy Spirit guide you. Come, Holy Spirit. Amen.